إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالًا كثيرًا ونساءً واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبًا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, when Ibrahim عليه السلام built the Kaaba, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, go and announce amongst the people that they have to come and perform pilgrimage to this house. Ibrahim alayhi salam said, O Allah, there is nobody here. How will they hear my message? And Allah said, upon you is the proclamation, and upon me is to see who responds. And so Ibrahim alayhi salam went to the top of the Kaaba, and he went to the mountain of Safa, and he went to the mountain of Abu Qubais, and he announced as loud as he could, that what Allah Azza wa Jalla told him in the Quran, وَأَذِّن فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ, that he said, O people, Allah has built a house for himself on this earth, and he has legislated upon you that you go and you perform the pilgrimage, so come and perform pilgrimage to this house. And Ibn Abbas said that when Ibrahim made this announcement, even the mountains, they took it. And every single thing that heard it, living or dead, inanimate or creature, they took this message. So much so that Ibn Abbas said that every single ruh, that it was written that it would do Hajj until the Day of Judgment, that ruh responded, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik, that they are going to respond to this call. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Prophet Ibrahim, وَأَذِّن فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ, give the adhan for Hajj. Proclaim the pilgrimage. Enough to the people, they have to come and do Hajj. يَأْتُوكَ, that people will come to you. وَأَذِّن فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا, that people are going to come to you walking. وَعَلَى كُلِّ ضَامِرٍ, and they're going to come to you on every single type of animal, even the animals that are weak. وَمِن كُلِّ فَجٍّ عَمِيقٍ, and they're going to come to you from every, فَجٍّ عَمِيقٍ means every far away place and road. So Allah is saying, people are going to come, number one, via any means possible. Walking or using an animal that otherwise people don't think should be used for traveling, they're going to come. And number two, they're going to come from every corner of the globe. You do the job of proclaiming and people will respond. Why will they respond? Allah says, لِيَشْهَدُوا مَنَافِعَ لَهُمْ, so that they will witness, they will bear testimony, they will participate in matters that will bring them benefit. لِيَشْهَدُوا مَنَافِعَ لَهُمْ, they will benefit by doing Hajj. And subhanAllah, brothers and sisters, over 4,000 years ago, the Prophet Ibrahim made this call. More than 4,000 years have gone by. And every single year, uninterrupted, for the last 4,000 years, the Prophet Ibrahim's call has been responded. And every single year, people are doing Hajj, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam to proclaim to the people. The Hajj is the most uninterrupted pilgrimage that has taken place in the history of mankind. The Hajj is the largest pilgrimage that takes place on an annual basis. Think about that. No other gathering on this earth is as large, or I should say no regular gathering. There are irregular gatherings every 10 years, every 15 years, something happens that breaks the Hajj. But this is a one-off event. In terms of annual gatherings, the Hajj is the number one religious gathering on the face of this earth. And can you imagine when the Prophet Ibrahim made this announcement, not a single creature heard, But Allah said, your job is to proclaim. My job is to find out who's going to respond. My job is to create those people. Can you imagine when he made that cry, not a single creature is in front of him to listen. And now we have a problem about the over quantity of people coming for Hajj, that the government has to restrict the number of people because the call is too much, because there are too many people answering the adhan that Prophet Ibrahim gave to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And notice as well, brothers and sisters, the continuity. Think about that. Think about, nothing has ever prevented the Hajj from taking place. Civil war, World War I and World War II, the biggest catastrophes and calamities in the world, never once in the history of this 4,000 years. Even in the days of Jahiliyyah before Islam, the pagans did Hajj, did they not? Even in the days of Jahiliyyah, from the time of Ismail alayhi salam, from the time of Ibrahim and his son Ismail, people have been regularly doing tawaf and sa'i and dhikr and dua and prayer and ritual and sacrifice all throughout these 4,000 years. Can you imagine how that promise has been fulfilled when Allah told Ibrahim, your job is to announce, my job is to figure out who's going to respond to that call. And as well, look at what Allah said. They're going to use every means of transportation. And Allah mentioned walking and animals that are typically unfit. Dhamir, ala kulli dhamir. Dhamir means the animals that are weak, the animals that don't have that much muscle, but people will still use them to get to the Hajj. And so if Allah mentioned those two things that are the most difficult to travel on, and that is walking on foot. To this day, brothers and sisters, every means of transport is used to get to the Hajj. To this day, there are people who walk all the way from the farthest lands. There are pilgrims that come from Uzbekistan and Tajikistan. They literally walk to this day. There are pilgrims that take the bus. There are pilgrims that still take their animals. There are peasants and they don't have the means to go in planes or in trains. So they still take their animals and they come for Hajj. And of course, there are pilgrims like most of us who will go in fancy airplanes. Every single transportation, Allah said, they will come to this house. And where will they come from? يَأْتُونَ مِن كُلِّ فَجٍّ عَمِيقٍ. They will come from every corner of the globe. Hajj is not only the largest gathering of humanity at a regular basis, it is also the most internationally diverse. Yes, once every 10-15 years there is a festival that is larger than the Hajj. For example, in Hinduism, there is a festival every 10 years that brings, they say, 7-8 million people, which is double Hajj. This is every 10 years. But even if the quantity is broken every 10 years, okay, look at the people who attend that pilgrimage. They are all from one ethnicity. You cannot compare that with the Hajj, where people from literally every single nation on earth, all 160 countries are represented in Hajj. Every skin color, every language, every tribe, every people. There is no doubt that Hajj is the greatest gathering of humanity on a regular basis, the most international, the largest. And if this is not a sign of the beauty of this religion, then what else would that sign be? And so Hajj is of the greatest sha'air, of the greatest symbols and signs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated. And we all know that Hajj is one of the five pillars of Islam. That our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْحَجْ فَحَجُّ. O people, Allah has prescribed for you that you have to do the pilgrimage. So therefore do the pilgrimage. Do the pilgrimage. And our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us so many blessings associated with the pilgrimage. He told us that when the person decides to do pilgrimage and he undertakes this journey, he becomes a guest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That the pilgrim, the Hajj, is a guest of Allah. He told us that when the pilgrim says the talbiyah, labbaik Allahumma labbaik, each and every creature, each and every rock and stone, each and every animal, each and every tree that hears that labbaik will testify on the day of judgment that this man responded to the call of Allah. He told us that when the hujjaj gather together in the plains of Arafat, He told us that when they gather together on the plains of Arafat, Allah Himself comes down to the lowest heavens and He boasts to the angels and He says, look at these people who have gathered together. Look at them. tired, dirty, disheveled, hungry. They're not even wearing the regular clothes. They travel from everywhere in order to respond to my call. Hear, Allah says, hear my angels, that I am calling you to testify, to witness that I have forgiven each and every one of them. And our Prophet ﷺ said, never is shaitan more humiliated than he is on the day of Arafah. Never is he feeling more depressed and more miserable than on the day of Arafah. Why? Because of what he sees of Allah's mercy. And our Prophet ﷺ told us that the Hajj, the one who goes for Hajj, every step that he takes, him or his animal or mount, every step that he takes, he is raised one level and one of his sins is forgiven. And our Prophet ﷺ said that when he was speaking to the Hujjaj, he said that be proud, be happy, because you are following in the footsteps of your father Ibrahim alayhis salam. What you're doing is not trivial. You are resurrecting. You are doing exactly what Ibrahim did 4,000 years ago. And he said, for those who are throwing the jamarat, that as you throw the stones of jamarat, know that Allah is recording for you. Allah is recording this for you. And he said, for those who are trimming and shaving their hairs off, he said, know that for every hair that falls, Allah will forgive your sins. Every hair that falls, Allah will forgive your sins. And he said regarding Muzdalifah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself praises Muzdalifah in the Quran. And Allah says, فَإِذَا أَفَضْتُ مِنْ عَرَفَاتٍ فَاذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ عِنْدَ الْمَشْعَلِ الْحَرَامِ. When you depart from Arafat, then stop and remember Allah in the sacred territory. So Allah specifies Muzdalifah, sacred territory, مَشْعَلِ الْحَرَامِ. وَاذْكُرُوهُ كَمَا هَدَاكُمْ. And praise him because of what he guided you. And our Prophet ﷺ said that when the person does the final tawaf al-ifada, that he does the tawaf of Hajj, and he does Hajj properly and perfectly, when he finishes that tawaf, the Prophet ﷺ said, it is as if he is as pure as the day his mother gave birth to him. It is as if he is as clean as the day his mother gave birth to him. He has no sins attached to him at all. And that is why the Prophet ﷺ said that the true Hajj, Al-Hajj Al-Mabrur, the accepted Hajj, has no reward less than paradise itself. There is no reward. If you do it properly, there's only one reward. There is no monetary amount. There's no daraja given. There's no quantity. It's only one reward. If you do it properly, Al-Hajj Al-Mabrur, لَيْسَ لَهُ جَزَاءٌ إِلَّا الْجَنَّةِ. The true Hajj, the proper Hajj that is done, accepted by Allah, it has no reward less than Jannah itself. And that is why going for Hajj is not just a blessing. It is wajib, it is fard, it is mandatory. It is something that is of the five pillars of this religion, brothers and sisters in Islam. The blessings are there. There are many other blessings as well. The khutbah does not allow me to give into all of them. But for example, our Prophet ﷺ said, this Hajj, this is a type of striving fi sabilillah, jihadun fi sabilillah, in which there's no qital, there's no hardship. Once a woman came to me and said, O Messenger of Allah, I want to participate along with you in your expeditions. I want to go and be in your expeditions. So the Prophet ﷺ said, should I not tell you of a striving that is better for you? She said, yes. So he said, the Hajj is the jihad for you. Your jihad is the Hajj. You go and you do the Hajj. And another hadith, he said, Al-Hajju jihadu kulli da'if. That those who are weak, they're not able to do proper striving in the way of Allah, their jihad will be going for the Hajj. So all of those blessings for the Hajj, for the pilgrimage to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And not only are these blessings there, but our Lord has equated the Hajj with the very essence of Islam. That he has said, this is of the pillars of Islam. And then he says, whoever rejects, فَمَنْ كَفَرَ, whoever rejects, meaning going for the Hajj, that Allah azza wa jalla will not guide those who have rejected. Brothers and sisters in Islam, somebody might ask me, that, oh Shaykh, why are you talking about Hajj when only 10 people or 15 people are going for Hajj? And the response is, firstly, to honor those who Allah has chosen this year to go for Hajj. Because wallahi, Allah has chosen them. And Allah has preferred them over us in this regard, that they are the guests of Allah. And so what do you think the honor will be when Allah has chosen them as their guests? Secondly, even if we don't go with them, if Allah has not willed us to go this year, at least let our hearts, let our minds, let our du'as go with them. And let us appreciate those blessings that has been given to some of us. And thirdly, and most importantly, brothers and sisters, the main reason why I'm talking about the Hajj in today's khutbah, not just that it's going to be after 2 weeks, but that sadly many of us have not even thought about going for the Hajj. Many of us do not understand the importance and the significance of going for Hajj. So for those amongst us who have not yet gone, it is important that they understand that this obligation, this duty, is not something that can be postponed. Rather, it needs to be effected, it needs to be done immediately. Brothers and sisters in Islam, the scholars have differed when Hajj is obligatory upon a person. The majority of scholars, the most of the madhahib, they say as soon as a person can afford the amount of money that is needed to go for Hajj, it becomes wajib immediately. And if they delay even 1 year, they are sinful. And one of the madhahib, this is the Shafi'i madhab, they say it is allowed to delay for a few years as long as you have it in your intention that you're going to go. Regardless of which madhab is right, the point is we don't know what the future holds. And we don't know how long we have to live. And there are some very strict ahadith and very strict statements of the Sahaba that really should cause us to feel a tension about going for the Hajj. In one hadith in Tirmidhi, and there's a difference of opinion, did the Prophet ﷺ say it? Is it authentic? Or is it a statement of Ali? Some say this is a statement of Ali ibn Abi Talib, and others say no, this is a statement of the Prophet ﷺ. That the Prophet ﷺ is reported to have said that whoever had the means and the capability to go for Hajj and did not go for Hajj, then he might as well die a Yahudi or Nasrani. This hadith in Tirmidhi. He might as well die a Yahudi or Nasrani. And others say this isn't a hadith, this is a statement of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Even if it's a statement of Ali, it's a very big deal. And it is well known, this is a statement from Umar, recorded in the books of history. Umar ibn al-Khattab said that, I wish that I send out people to every city to check who is there that has the means to go for Hajj but has not gone. And if he hasn't gone, then I will put the jizya on them. Because these people, he said, لَيْسُوا بِمُسْلِمِينَ لَيْسُوا بِمُسْلِمِينَ. And this is Umar in his khilafah, he was thinking of doing this. That those who haven't gone for Hajj and they're capable of doing it, I might as well put the jizya on them, he said. And this shows us, brothers and sisters, that even if you follow the other position which says you may delay a few years, there must be a plan. There must be a niyyah. There must be a vision that, okay, I need to go as soon as possible. Even if you're not sinful for 1 year, 2 year delay according to that madhab, still there must be the vision to go. Because brothers and sisters, in one hadith the Prophet ﷺ said that, O you who believe, be quick to do your Hajj because you don't know what is written for you tomorrow. It's a common sense that be quick to do the Hajj. Don't delay the Hajj because you don't know what is written for you in the future. How many years do you have left? You don't know. And realize, brothers and sisters, there is no doubt one of the reasons why people are confused about the Hajj is that they think that the Hajj has more conditions than the other four pillars of Islam. Now this is true, but what are these conditions? Only two conditions. In order to make Hajj wajib, just like the other pillars, Salah, Zakah, Ramadan, it's the same level. But you have two conditions to get to that level. What is the condition? Number one, you're physically fit. So if you're an invalid, if you're not able to walk, if you have a problem being physically active, then okay, it is forgiven. It's forgiven. But for most of us who are able to live regular or semi-regular lives, that condition is met. The second condition, one must be financially capable of going for Hajj. And what does it mean financially capable? It means that you're able to go on a Hajj package that is suitable for your socioeconomic status. That you choose a Hajj package that is suitable. So if you are a middle class person, then you will choose a middle package. You don't have to, it will not be wajib when you go on the very lowest package. No, it is not wajib. Allah does not put a burden more than we can bear. Even though if one were to do this, it would be good and the obligation is met. But it is wajib when you can go according to your means. For example, if somebody says, well, I could afford a boat ride all the way to Saudi Arabia from here, right? If I go on a ship from here and I go another ship, perhaps I can squeeze in the Hajj for $1,500. The Sharia says, look, if you're an average income person and you typically are living a socioeconomic status that you would not take a ship, then what is wajib for you is to afford a plane ticket and to afford a package that is suitable for your level. Now, if somebody says, I'm going to go with the fanciest package, and he doesn't have that type of background, this is a sin. This is a sin. This is israf. Every person knows his or her level, and so you choose the package that is suitable for your socioeconomic level. Also, brothers and sisters, I'm going to say a point that is a bit technical. I want everybody to pay attention to this and not misquote or misunderstand me. The Hajj, what is obligatory is that every person pays for himself or herself. This is what is wajib. And if a person cannot afford to pay for himself or herself, then the Hajj is not wajib. So, the father does not have to pay for the children. Even if the children are baligh, suppose he has a son who is 20 years old. The father is not obliged to pay for the child or to pay for this young man. But if he pays, then of course the obligation is done. You may perform Hajj on somebody's gift. So if the son accepts the gift from the father and says, yes, okay, I will go with Hajj, and the father offers this gift, the Hajj has been accepted, no problem. But the son is not obliged to go for Hajj if he does not have the money himself. Right? Neither is the father obliged to pay for the son. Now, so far everybody would understand. Well, I want to impress upon you that from a fiqh standpoint, the same understanding applies between the spouses as well. And what I mean by this, neither spouse is obliged to pay for the other. It's not wajib. And therefore, if one of the two spouses does not have an independent income and is not able to spend for a Hajj, then that spouse is exempt from going for the Hajj. Now suppose the other spouse volunteers and says, no, I will pay for your Hajj. Then of course this is good, and especially, let's be frank here, the main problem comes that, or the main issue comes that many of our sisters do not work, and the husbands are the ones working. So if the husband takes his wife along, then we say this is noble, this is gentlemanly, this is what he should be encouraged to do, but he's not obliged to do this. Why do I say this? Because, brothers and sisters, because if somebody says, I cannot afford to go for Hajj because I cannot afford to take 2, 3, 4, 5 people, we tell him, no, this is a mistake. You are not obliged to pay for 5 people. You don't have to bring your family and kids. You don't have to pay for 3 of your children. You don't have to. So if you're delaying Hajj because you're waiting for every single member of your household to be taken, we say, no. You're not allowed to delay the Hajj for this reason, as long as you can pay for yourself. If you can pay for yourself, then Hajj has been made wajib upon you. Now I reiterate, of course, we expect spouses to be generous with each other. We expect them to take care of each other's Hajj expenses if the one is earning and the other is not earning. But what is my point for mentioning this? It should not be delayed because of this reason. This is not the reason we should delay it. Why? Because the cost of Hajj is getting more and more expensive. And every year we delay, subhanAllah, it looks like another $1,000 are added every year. Well, it looks like. So, my point being, the person needs to understand, when is Hajj wajib upon me? When I can afford to go with my earnings. And if somebody cannot afford to go because they're not earning money, they are forgiven, it's exempt, there is no wajib upon them. That on the Day of Judgment, they're not going to be asked, why did you go for Hajj if they didn't have any money to go for Hajj? So, brothers and sisters, I need to impress upon you that Hajj is wajib for those who can afford it for themselves. Now, I also want to stress here that Shaytan comes and gives us excuses. He gives us many excuses. I'll just mention two of them. The first main excuse, oh, Hajj is too expensive. Hajj is too expensive. It's too much money for me. Well, frankly, if that's a legitimate excuse, then that's acceptable in the Sharia. That Hajj is getting expenses, and these days it's costing almost 10 times what it used to cost 10, 15 years ago because of all of the changes that have taken place. Nonetheless, brothers and sisters, Hajj is more obligatory than almost all of your other expenses. And therefore, even if you cannot afford, let's say, $6,000 right now, if you were to save up for a year or two, Every month put aside $100, $150, $200. If you were to save up and you can afford Hajj, then wallahi it is wajib upon you. Hajj is more important than your retirement fund. Hajj is more important than your college fund for your children. Hajj is more important than many of the other funds you're saving up for. Because Hajj is wajib upon you, just like the obligation of Salah and Siyam. Would you delay the Salah and Siyam for a weak excuse? No. Similarly, you're not allowed to delay the Hajj except for a genuinely legitimate excuse. So if you can save up the money in a year or two, then that is the money for your Hajj. Then brothers and sisters, if you don't have a plan to save, how will you ever save? Wallahi, we all know money does not grow on trees. You're not just going to wake up and have $10,000 in your bank account out of nowhere. You want something, you have to plan and save up for it. Just like you want a car, you want a house, what do? You sacrifice certain things in order for the ultimate goal to be met. Well then, once you've met, and you know, scholars have discussed in the books of fiqh, which is more important for the young man, getting married or going for Hajj? Regardless of which position is right, look at the question. Look at the question, right? That which one is takes priority if a person has money? Should he first get married or should he first go for Hajj? Look at the mentality of the fuqaha, and why did they have it? Because Hajj is an obligation that is equivalent to the fasting and the zakah and the salah. It's the same five pillars. And therefore they discuss these types of questions. So brothers and sisters, the issue of money. Realize, where there's a will, there's a way. And if you're able to save up over the course of 3, 4, 5, 10 years, well then, you better set aside the saving funds for the Hajj. You better set aside legitimate funds, obviously, for the Hajj, so that you're able to go 1 year. Also realize, brothers and sisters, that our Prophet ﷺ promised us, if we truly believe in Allah, that Hajj is one of the most money-making opportunities in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Going for Hajj will get you rich. This is what the Prophet ﷺ said. That should I not tell you of something that will get you rid of your poverty, of your poor, of your lack of wealth? They said, what? He said, one Hajj after another and one Umrah after another. Going continuously to the house of Allah. And this is a test of faith, do we truly believe or not? If we spend $5,000-$10,000, the Prophet is saying Allah will give us much more than that. In money, forget the reward, that's there of course. Even in the cash, even in this world, if we genuinely go for the sake of Allah, that the Prophet ﷺ said, of the greatest ways to increase one's wealth is to go regularly, not even one, regularly for Hajj and Umrah. Keep on going every time, and this is of the best ways to earn wealth. So we are saying, we don't have money, but going for Hajj will bring that money. And the second excuse that many people use is a very flimsy excuse, is an excuse from the waswas of shaitan. And that excuse is, they say, I'm not spiritually ready yet. I'm not that good of a Muslim yet. When I go for Hajj, I want to be a walking angel on this earth. Once I am completely pure and I feel qualified, then I will answer the call. Well, like, brothers and sisters, it's obvious this is waswas of shaitan. When will you be pure? When will I be pure? When will you become an angel? It's not going to happen. In fact, going for Hajj will make you better. Not the other way around, that I'll wait till I'm better, then I'll go for Hajj. No. You're involved in a sin, you have an issue, you have a guilty conscience. Wallahi, Hajj is even more obligatory on you then. Because there is nothing that cleanses one's sins like the Hajj does. There is nothing that purifies one's life like the Hajj does. And you and I, we both know, this is a reality we sense. When the Hujjaj come back, we sense that they are changed people. Is that not the case? Is that not the case? Every one of us, even if we have not gone, we know people who have gone. That those who have come back from Hajj, they have a different now sense of religion and religiosity. Why? Because the Hajj, anybody who goes sincerely, the Hajj will change this person. It's just impossible not to go and not be affected. It's impossible. And therefore, brothers and sisters, the second excuse is completely flimsy. It is completely ludicrous to think that I'm only going to go for Hajj when I'm ready spiritually. It doesn't work that way. The Hajj will make you a spiritual person and not the other way around. Brothers and sisters, the Hajj is an obligation upon every one of us. If we have physical capabilities and if we have the financial means, and if we don't have the financial means, we had better start planning for that. Because wallahi, brothers and sisters, if we don't have a plan, it's never going to happen. If we don't set aside some money every month, perhaps for some of us, the amount for Hajj is too much for 1 year. Okay, 5 years, 10 years, but it must be on your plan. It must be on your vision that I'm going to set aside every month, I'll sacrifice this and that, set something aside. And inshaAllah ta'ala, when you do that, you yourself will see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless you. You might have a 10-year plan, but because you made that plan, because you dedicated that, oh Allah, I'm going to answer the call, you will find that your money increases just because Allah knows you're going for Hajj. You will find that your financial situation changes for the better because you have demonstrated to Allah that you're willing to answer that call that our father Ibrahim alayhi salam made over 4,000 years ago. وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا وَعَلَى كُلِّ ضَامِرْ يَأْتِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍّ عَمِيقٍ لِيَشْهَدُوا مَنَافِعَ لَهُمْ. بارك الله لي ولكم فقهاء عظيم ونفعني وإياكم بما فيه من الآيات والذكر الحكيم. أقول ما تسمعون وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين كل ذنب فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. Can we have the people move forward because we are completely packed? Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, al-Wahid, al-Ahad, al-Fard, al-Samad, al-Ladhi lam yalid, wa lam yulad, wa lam yakun lahu kufuwan ahad, wa ba'du. Brothers and sisters, the Hajj coincides with one of the greatest, in fact, the greatest period of the year. And it is not a coincidence. The timing of Hajj and the blessings of Hajj, they are linked to the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَالْفَجْرِ وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ. Allah swears qasam by the 10 days and the 10 nights. And the majority opinion is that these 10 days and nights are the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. These are the days of Dhul Hijjah. وَالْفَجْرِ وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ. And our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that there is no deed that is more beloved to Allah than a good deed that is done during these 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. And he did not specify every type of good deed he mentioned. I repeat, there is no deed that is more beloved to Allah than a good deed that is done in these 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. They said, O Messenger of Allah, وَلَا الْجِهَادُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Even striving in the way of Allah. And the Prophet ﷺ said, even striving, except a man who goes and he comes back with nothing, i.e. he gives himself and everything fi sabilillah, maybe that is better. But apart from that, every other good deed in these 10 days is more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these 10 days will begin with the first of Dhul Hijjah, which this year will begin either next Tuesday or next Wednesday, depending on when the moon is sighted. Either next Tuesday or next Wednesday, we're going to begin those 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. And so, brothers and sisters, let us make a conscious effort in those 10 days to increase our worship of Allah. For those who are going for Hajj, this is the best deed. Alhamdulillah, you've done it. You've chosen the best deed possible. For those who are not going for Hajj, much can be done. First and foremost, what Allah Himself mentions and what the Prophet ﷺ mentioned, extra dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Extra dhikr of Allah. Allah says, وَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْلُومَاتٍ. Remember Allah on those specified days, meaning the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. وَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ. Remember Allah. And our Prophet ﷺ, when he himself said that these 10 days are the best days, he said, فَأَكْثِرُوا فِيهِ مِنَ التَّحْمِيدِ وَالتَّكْبِيرِ وَالتَّحْلِيلِ. So increase saying Allahu Akbar and La ilaha illallah and Alhamdulillah. Increase doing your adhkar in these 10 days. And these adhkar are done without any condition to them. Wherever you are, whenever you are, you raise your voice with the dhikr of Allah. And in the very last few days, every salah, we will do the dhikr jointly together, as the sunnah is that after Eid, we're going to start doing the dhikr communally for 3 days. Also, what we can do in these 10 days is to fast. And the fasting is rewarded in all of these 9 days. The 10th is, of course, Eid. So we do not fast on the 10th itself because it is Eid. But especially the 9th of Dhul-Hijjah, which is the day of Arafah. When the Hujjaj are standing at Arafat, those who are not in Hajj, they should strive to become close to Allah by fasting on that day. And the fast of the 9th of Dhul-Hijjah is the most beloved fast after Ramadan. And our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that it forgives the sins of 2 years, the year before and the year after. And so, brothers and sisters, stingy and miserly is the one, lazy is the one who hears this hadith and yet does not fast on this day. When 2 years sins are forgiven, wallahi, brothers and sisters, if we were to be given $1,000, $10,000, we would fast multiple days. This one blessing of having 2 years sins forgiven, you cannot put a price tag on it. And that is given to those who fast on the 9th of Dhul-Hijjah. And that will most likely be a Thursday this year. But keep in touch with the dates. But most likely it will be not this Thursday, but the Thursday coming up. And if you can increase even more than just the 9th, on the 8th, on the 7th, as many as you can, this is recommended. Another good deed in these 10 days is the Udhiyah, the Qurbani. And our Prophet ﷺ strongly encouraged, and some scholars say it is wajib, and there's an ikhtilaf, is it wajib or not? Whoever believes it is wajib, alhamdulillah, good, and whoever thinks that it is sunnah, still it is sunnah to do it. So one should try to do the qurbani, the udhiyah, the sacrifice. And of course, the sacrifice, the sunnah is that one does it himself in his locality and then gives some of the meat to the poor, some of the meat to family and friends, and he may also eat of the meat himself or herself. However, in our case, many times we send the money to our relatives back home because we feel they are more deserving, and there's no problem doing that. Nonetheless, some of us should also do it here to keep this tradition and spirit alive. And if somebody sends back home, and frankly, alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed many of us, we can do both. That we can sponsor an animal back home, which is what, $40, $50, and then we can also do one over here as well. Alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed us. Those who are able to, they should try to do it here to keep the tradition alive as well. But if they do it back home, then it will suffice the obligation or the sunnah. Also realize that our Prophet ﷺ said, whoever decides to do the udhiyah, then he should resemble the hujjaj in one way, and that is to leave off the trimming and the shaving. To leave off, just like the hujjaj don't do it, he too should not do it for these 10 days. Why? Because then he's going to feel as if he's doing something along with them, that he is participating in their rituals. Look, brothers and sisters, even though most of the ummah does not go for Hajj, our Prophet is telling us to be with them, to think about them, to go in their journey, at least with our mind and our heart, even if we cannot be with them physically. And this is only for the one who has decided to do the udhiyah. As for somebody who's not doing the udhiyah, then there's no issue of shaving and trimming. And also, the family members of the one who is doing the udhiyah. So suppose the father or the husband is doing the udhiyah, the wife and the children, they don't have this restriction on them. The restriction is only on the one who is paying for the udhiyah, that this person who is paying should not trim or shave for these 10 days in order to resemble the hujjaj. And these are the only two things on the one who is doing the udhiyah. And of course, apart from this, every single other good deed that one can do, whether it is sadaqah, whether it is sponsoring orphans, whether it is reading Quran, praying tahajjud, every good deed in these days, it becomes the most blessed of all good deeds. And so the wise person is the one who will benefit from these 10 days. Ayyaman ma'dudat, Allah says. They're just a limited number of days. And another verse, ayyaman ma'lumat. They are a well-known and appointed number of days. And Allah says, wal fajri wal ayalin ashr. They're only 10 days. So the wise person takes advantage of this and realize, brothers and sisters, the blessings of these 10 days is even more than the blessings of Ramadan during the days. I have said this before in Ramadan, that the last 10 nights of Ramadan are more blessed than the 10 nights of Dhul-Hijjah. But the first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah are more blessed than the last 10 days of Ramadan. The daytimes, the most blessed of them is the days of Dhul-Hijjah. No other year, no other part of the year is as blessed. And of course, the culmination of this is Eid al-Adha. And the Eid al-Adha, by the way, is the bigger Eid and the stronger Eid and the more blessed Eid. Many of us culturally, we feel Eid al-Fitr is more important. They're both important, but the Eid al-Adha is the more important of the two. And it is the bigger of the two, and therefore, brothers and sisters, every one of us should try our best to pray Eid al-Adha. In fact, it is wajib to pray Eid. It is wajib to pray Eid. It is not just sunnah. We have to pray Eid. But yet Allah knows that in this country we don't get Eid off. So for those who are not able to take half a day or 2 hours, for those who genuinely cannot, we ask that Allah forgives them. But otherwise, if you're able to take off from your job, even for 2 hours, that's all you need. Eid will be early in the morning, the exact time will be announced, but it's going to be early in the morning. You'll be back before lunch in your office. That you try to negotiate with your boss, with your company, that take the whole day or half a day or just 2 hours off. And if you still cannot do it, Allah knows your situation. Otherwise, Eid al-Adha and Eid al-Fitr, the both of them are wajib for every Muslim, male or female, adult to attend, every single one of us. This is one of those signs of Islam, that the community comes together and worships Allah and praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلِتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. That we praise Allah and glorify Him because of what He has guided us, and we thank Him for this. Brothers and sisters in Islam, the Hujjaj are the guests of Allah. Our Prophet ﷺ said, الحجاج والعمار وفد الله تعالى. That those who are going for Hajj and those who are going for Umrah, they are the delegations, they are the guests of Allah. Allah has invited them and they have responded. So when they ask Him, He will give them. Allah has invited, so they have responded. So when they ask, He will give. Brothers and sisters, for those who are going for Hajj this year, we pray that Allah accepts your Hajj. We pray that Allah Azza wa Jal facilitates your matters. And we pray that you also pray for us when you go for Hajj. For those who are not going for Hajj, then each and every one of us should feel a sense of loss and a sense of positive jealousy that one day I want to go as well. If not next year, then the year after that. But every one of us needs to have that sincere desire to go for Hajj. اللهم إني داع فأمنوا اللهم لا تدع في هذا اليوم ذنبا إلا غفرت ولا هما إلا فرجت ولا دينا إلا قضيت ولا مريضا إلا شفيت ولا عسيرا إلا يسرت اللهم اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم من أرادنا أو أراد الإسلام والمسلمين بسوء فاشغله بنفسه واجعل تدميره في تدبيره يا قوي يا عزيز عباد الله إن الله تعالى أمركم بأمر بدأ به بنفسه وثنى بملائكة قدسه وثلث بكم أيها المؤمنون من جنه وإنسه فقال عز من قائل عليما إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وأنعم على عبدك ورسولك محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين عباد الله إن الله تعالى يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم واشكروه يزد لكم ولذكر الله تعالى أكبر وأقم الصلاة